Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Brenham Presbyterian Church Online. And whether you're a member here or a returning visitor, or maybe this is the first time you've tuned in, please be welcome here at our worship service. If you don't have a copy of our worship bulletin, there's a link on the YouTube. You can punch it up and download it so that you can participate in the prayers and the call and responses in the service this morning. Please join me in the call to worship. God is waiting for us with a tender heart and a searching question. God is ready for us with truth and wisdom from a deep well. God is sending us to pray and witness every day. God is He. Let the conversation begin. Let us worship God together. Let us open our service this morning with our opening meditation hymn, God the Omnipotent. You'll find the words in your worship bulletin this morning. Let us pray. O God, you are infinite, eternal, and unchangeable, glorious in holiness, full of love and compassion, abundant in grace and truth. Your works everywhere praise you, and your glory is revealed in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Therefore, we praise you, blessed and holy Trinity, one God, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, if we say that we have no sin, then we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Let us therefore confess our sins before God and one another, first using the unison prayer of confession you'll find in your worship bulletin this morning. Let us pray together. Free us from the tendency to label people and ideas, and allow us instead to lean into mercy and kindness. In the stillness of these moments, we acknowledge the times when we have been less than kind, merciful, and open. Thank you for never banning us from your presence, loving God. Help us to so love and accept others. As we enter into this time of prayer, O God, we offer our gratitude that you are always present to us. Instill in us a desire to so listen to others. Help us to listen with open hearts and open minds that others might feel safe in our presence. Instill in us a spirit of serenity that others might feel accepted in your non-judgmental grace, even as you grant us your forgiveness and grace. Amen. Let us continue with silent prayers of confession. Let us pray. By God's mercy, we are forgiven. By God's mercy, we are made whole. By God's mercy, we are equipped to serve others. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, prepare us to hear from the Scriptures. Sometimes it can be easy to dismiss a passage that seems familiar. We've heard it before, and so we disengage. Yet we know that your word is powerful and that it is calling us to live like Jesus. Do not let us turn off our ears so quickly. Help us to listen well and respond with obedience. Let us see what it is you are doing through the Scriptures we hear today. You are working, and we want to join you. Amen. Several pieces of Scripture this morning. Beginning with one snippet from Proverbs 12:25. Anxiety weighs down the human heart, but a good word cheers up. A piece of Psalm 33. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and all their hosts by the breath of his mouth. He gathered the waters of the sea as in a bottle. He put the deeps in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Gospel according to John, beginning of the prelude. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome. And finally, a reading from the Epistle to the Hebrews. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. been thinking a lot lately about how words frame our world. How words frame our world. You know, indeed, the ancients believed that all of creation was framed by words. Hebrew scriptures read, "Then God said, let there be light, and there was light." Indeed, this is how the ancients thought about it, that the universe was framed by words. Now, science tells us that it didn't exactly all come about all at one time. The beginning of it did, but really it didn't happen all at once. In fact, it's a process that's been unfolding for some 13.7 billion years. And it has been a process. It began with the Big Bang, and then elementary particles like photons, the inflation of the universe, forces that are strong and weak, electromagnetic and gravity, protons, neutrons, electrons, neutrinos, subatomic particles, hydrogen ions fused with helium ions, and on it goes. Protoclouds form, coalesced into stars, and stars into systems, and systems into galaxies. At some point in time, life began to form. Science uses words and numbers, mathematics, to describe what God was doing in creation. The authors of the ancient scriptures use words to describe that God was the one doing it. And whether by religion or science, the process of creation is framed symbolically, whether it's in the language of mathematics or the language of words. God spoke words that brought things into creation, that framed it. This is a metaphor, but it is a true metaphor, and it is a powerful metaphor. And indeed, this whole idea continues all the way through the Bible. It's not just a one-shot affair in Genesis. We read this morning, for example, of some Psalm 33. Put it this way. But by the word of the Lord, the heavens, plural, were made, and all of their hosts by the breath of his mouth. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. As a side note, maybe it isn't just one universe, maybe it's multiple realities. Heavens is plural. But whatever the case, the idea is that God brought it about. And this is picked up in the New Testament. We heard this morning when the Gospel of John refers simultaneously to the Word which creates and the Word which saves. The Word, the Logos. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. From the beginning, God's words of creation were spoken into the formless void, and the process of creation was framed. And I can't help but wonder, are we alone in this revelation? When God first spoke into the void, likely there was no other created being yet. But as I look up at the stars at night, I can't help but wonder if around some of those stars so far away are other planets. And certainly we know that they exist, exoplanets they're called. Billions of them, we are told. And if there are billions of them, does it not stand to reason that some of those also bear life by the hand of God? And if so, does God speak to them? Does the word of the Lord come to some other race of beings on a planet circling a star that perhaps not even our most powerful telescopes can see? I don't know. Likely, but I don't know. But what I do know is that in time, this one little ball of swirling gas coalesced and cooled into what we call the Earth. And then life began its long evolutionary climb by the hand of God, and humanity eventually, in all of its diversity, developed. And God began to speak to humanity, to us, in different and diverse ways. I covered some of those in my sermon last week. But this morning, I want to point out one in particular, and that is the word of the Lord came to a people on a mountaintop and with words carved in stone gave a law and created a community. And we inherited that. It can't stay confined just with one people. Because you see, the word of the Lord goes as God commands. The word of the Lord came to Moses. And this is part of what the word of the Lord said. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. Millennia later, the Apostle Paul, commenting on this very piece of scripture, writes in the book of Romans, so it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who shows mercy. The Spirit of God is free to dispense, plant, and use words as she wills. And yes, the Hebrew word for spirit is a feminine noun, ruach. It is not to be determined by us how these words will be heard or interpreted. The word of the Lord and how it is heard is determined by the Lord. But what do we mean by this phrase, word of the Lord, or the word of God? What do we mean by that? Is it just language? Just inert words on a page? Or is it something more, something richer, something fuller, something bigger? I think our reading this morning from the Epistle to the Hebrews might help us frame an answer or answers to some of that. Because the very first way to think about this is that the Epistle of the Hebrews, epistle means letter, it was written down. So theologians call the word of the Lord written down in a language. What we call the scriptures, the Bible. Now we Presbyterians hold that all of scripture is inspired by the Holy Spirit. But we also hold that inspiration was set down by fallen, fallible human beings prone to error. Not only that, but their understanding of the world was shaped by their own time and place. Their use of words was shaped by that. We hold that God inspired scripture. We hold that it is true and full of truths. Some of those truths are literal. Some are poetic. Some are metaphorical. Some are faith statements. But we don't hold that it was inerrant because it was set down by human beings. But we do hold that it is full of truth. And sometimes those words of the Lord are really meant to mediate what happens between human beings. We hear that this morning in the psalm. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. And so it is that this letter was written down. It was written down in the Hebrew language. It was translated later into Greek, into other languages. This is the word of the Lord written. But is it more than just the inert words on a page? The Epistle to the Hebrews this morning reads this: indeed, the word of God is living. It is living. It's not some monolithic relic from the dead past. It's not meant to be enforced with a literalism that confines who we are and who we know to customs millennia old. The words themselves may be kind of static. They may be bound by history, but how we interpret those words matters. And we're called to interpret them in our day and in our time as each generation lives. Because life, to be truly lived, must be able to change and grow. And that calls us to expand our understanding of scripture and how it's applied, and so we must be free to engage the world of the reader today. To encounter the living word is to encounter that which struggles with life. Because that's what it means to be alive. And such issues as global warming, climate change, nuclear war, a pandemic, the rights of marginalized people, and all these other issues aren't meant to be separated. They're meant to be engaged with the Word of God written as a living organism. Not as a matter of the ancient words dominating how we live, but rather informing us in a conversation to help us interpret the will of a loving God in our time, our place, in the midst of our problems and challenges. The Word of God is living, and as such must engage the world of the living. But the Epistle of the Hebrews doesn't leave it there. When it refers to the Word of God living, there's another meaning as well, and that is particular to us, to those of us who call ourselves the followers of Jesus Christ. The word here is the Word incarnate. The very next line says, "And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account." Him here has a dual reference. One is to God, but the other is to the great high priest, Jesus Christ. The Greek pronoun is very specific, him. Here is a reference to the Word of God in human form. He is the one to whom we give an account. We are accountable to Jesus for our actions. But he is also the one who loves us, died for us. And just in those words, we frame him not as a word to be feared, but a comfort to be embraced. A comfort to be embraced. But the author of the Epistle of the Hebrews uses another word to frame the Word of the Lord as well. And that is the word sword. Indeed, the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It's able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Notice, though, that the living Word is not really referred to as a sword. It's referred to as being sharper than a sword, greater than a two-edged sword. Unfortunately, all too often the Bible has been used as a sword to conquer, to hurt, and such is a grave sin. And I think we all need to be willing, we Christians, to acknowledge that this is historically true, so that the living and incarnate Word of the Lord can become an instrument of peace, as it should be. And indeed, in the very language that's used here, I think this is hinted at. Now, there may be more words for sword in the ancient Greek language than any other language. I had a professor in seminary who said, if you're reading classical Greek and you bump into a word you don't know what it is, 9 times out of 10, it's some new word for sword. But the particular word used here for sword has another meaning as well. Its root really comes from the word dispute. Argument. It can mean fighting, quarrel, strife. Indeed, the Word of the Lord is sharper than any dispute, any quarrel. It brings peace. If we will but believe it. If we will but believe it. And in order to believe it, we must do it. And that brings us to the word proclaim. And yes, that is a sermon. But what's being referred to here in the epistle is more than just a sermon preached on Sunday morning. Indeed, the Word of God is living and active. It is active. That Greek word can also translate as powerful or effective. The Word of God is powerful and effective, but only if we believe it, and in believing it, live it, demonstrate it, do it. And here's the thing. Our mortal words are an important part of that. They frame the world. I recently got a pointed lesson in that through encountering a social media maybe you've heard of, and that's TikTok. Now, I thought TikTok at first was just something that, you know, young kids were doing. It's got maybe a short message and a lot of music. But actually, as it turns out, an awful lot of Christian preachers are using this very short form called TikTok to get the word of the Lord across, often to people who've never heard of it. My daughter, Mariah, is one who uses TikTok. And so it is, I was furnished with a link from my wife, from a guy who goes by the handle, because everyone has a handle on TikTok, Rev Timothy. Now, Rev Timothy ain't young. In fact, his beard's longer than mine. But recently, he quoted a poem by Thomas Dougherty. It's really more of a haiku, not formally, but it reminds me more of a haiku. And the title of it is The Question and the Words After Answer It. And it's titled, Why Bother? Why bother? Because right now there is someone out there with a wound in the exact shape of your words. Wow. Right now there is someone out there with a wound in the exact shape of your words. And we've all had that experience. I have. Said something we wish we could take back. But viewed in a larger sense, I'm here to tell you that there are people out there in the world with a wound in the exact shape of the word of the Lord, which has been used not to bring life, but to confine, constrain, and put down. How we interpret Scripture matters. The words we use to interpret Scripture matter. Reverend Cameron Trimble is another person that I've been following. Recently, she quotes a Holocaust survivor, Breanne Eisler. And Ms. Eisler wants us to look at how we use language every day. That we have unconscious use of language that really is more negative than we may mean it to. And she suggests the following. Instead of saying fight injustice, say heal injustice. Instead of saying killing time, say filling time. Instead of saying, I really crushed it, say, I really brought it to life. Reverend Trimble goes on to say, these are little correctives. Until I saw this list, I didn't see how I created a world through my words that undermined my deepest held values. We speak our world into existence. As we dream of a more just world for all, perhaps the starting place is speaking of peace, love, grace, and healing. What we say determines what we will see. We are in this together. And I believe that she's right. I believe she's right. How we use words matter. How we interpret and live the word of God matters. I think our reading from Proverbs on a day-to-day level just sums it up. Anxiety weighs down the human heart, but a good word cheers it up. Anxiety weighs down the human heart, but a good word cheers it up. And friends, the good word is the word of the Lord, the word of God. It can bring life and freedom and justice and love and liberation. If we will live it for ourselves and for the sake of others. May God bless you all. Amen. May the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord. Let's take a moment of silent reflection upon the word proclaimed. Amen. I invite you to join together and say what we believe using the ancient baptismal formula known as the Apostles' Creed. You'll find it in your worship bulletin this morning. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us come together and pray the prayers of intercession and petition. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray for those locked in circumstances beyond their control, restrained by oppressors and seeing no end to their captivity. May they discover hope buried in deep suffering. Through Jesus Christ, who shared the weakness and despair of human life, yet gave even death a new outcome and brought resurrection from a closed tomb. We pray for the church, set in the world to show how people belong together and how your gifts are given to be shared. Grant that as we feel for the rejection and voicelessness of others, we may meet Christ in them and bear witness in his transforming love. We pray for the communities in which we live and work, for people under stress and unable to deal with their difficulties, for those who seek comfort in ways which bring no help, for all who are fearful. Grant us grace to show by our concern and actions how each is loved and valued by you. We remember those now hidden from us, but at home with you. We give thanks especially for those who have strengthened our weak faith, built up our trust in you, and by their lives have drawn us into the life of Christ, who died in weakness and reigns in glory. Amen. And now, as our Lord has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. There remains a lot going on in the life of your church. And the missions and ministries that we carry out are probably even more important in a time of pandemic. Our Galilee garden is back up and growing, having been through the heat of the summer. Good food given to people in the name of Jesus Christ. We continue to support Presbyterian Children's Home and Services, which gives a place for displaced families and families under stress, and particularly children. There's so many things that we support. And we do so out of a love for Jesus Christ. If you feel that you could share some of your financial resources, and the amount really isn't important, but if you feel like you could to help support our mission and ministries, of which this worship service is but one, we would love to have your participation. You can do so by sending a check to Brenham Presbyterian Church, 1005 Green Street, Brenham, Texas, 77833. That goes to a secure lockbox. It's picked up by someone on our finance committee. We are a nonprofit. We do keep records. We're happy to give you an end-of-the-year statement. I am told that our website is currently down. And so PayPal, or actually the secured giving link on there may not be working. That's not on our end, apparently, it's on the provider. We'll let you know just as soon as that comes back up. Now, we would never ask anyone to give to the church if they themselves are under financial stress or difficulty. We understand. And if you're in that situation and cannot share, then we would ask you to participate in our mission, our ministries, make them part of who you are by praying for us, praying for this church, for the pastoral staff, for the session of elders, for the music ministers, all who work, worship, and participate here, either physically or online. By doing so, you become a part of the mission and ministries, the body of Christ here at Burnham Presbyterian Church, and your prayers are always welcome. Let us sing our closing hymn, Praise Ye the Lord, the Almighty. good word cheers the heart. You know, a good word spoken in any situation, a word of compliment, a word that uplifts and encourages, can always be of help. And heaven knows in these stressful times, I don't think there are enough good words out there. Those words frame for a person, for a moment, something that's important. It might be confidence. It might be comfort. It might be companionship. It could be anything. So I charge you in everything you say and everything you do this week, live out the gospel of Jesus Christ by speaking a good word to someone, to anyone. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Sisters and brothers in Christ, go in peace.